So that's how this organization is the moral. That this organization will only know how to solve problems in one way, a single way, and not through a theoretical use of violence to solve any problems, versus to the plurality of nonviolent solutions that you and I already shared. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I agree with a lot of it. The only thing I think is, well, with taxes, it is kind of important to keep that kind of system.
Oh, so I want these services too. So like, you're saying like, I want roads, right? I want security, I want law, I want first class smell, right? I want alcohol. So what is the government objective? Government has a monopoly on the services you and I want, right? They have a monopoly in which you don't have the economic freedom though to cancel and subscribe as you work from a real business service, right? Like Netflix, try to increase the prices two years ago, people, oh, forget that, cancel and subscribe, go to Hulu, right? When government increases the prices, you don't have that freedom of economic choices at all. Right. So you don't have the economic freedom to compete entrepreneurially against the monopolies in order to say, I can provide you a better service. It's not going to be abusive or harmful to you, the consumer.
Well, you could technically move to a different country, I guess.
Well, every country has a monopoly. Yeah. That's what all governments are. So the same system that runs here functions all over the place. Yeah, that's very true. Like China, and here you see 2 million people in prison cages, many of them for victims of crimes. You know, that's kind of horrific as well, obviously, right? They have more prisoners here than China. The United States has more prisoners than any tax farm or any kind of country in the world, right? I would say that's kind of horrid and horrible, the situation, circumstances here. So they will, they will be different from one place to another, but I'm going back to like what we're talking about. You want services like first class mail, right? Like, you go to the post office, you don't use the post office? And what about alcohol? Okay. But the post office is a good example how a government monopoly functions. So when you have a government monopoly, costs go up. They have no competitors, right? You have no reason to improve. Quality depreciates. So costs would be like, the people say, how do you feel about the rise in cost gaps? Not like I have a choice. Not like I go to McDonald's increases the prices, I go to Cookout, I go to Wendy's, I go to Burger King, right? When government increases the prices and taxes, you don't have a choice to go anywhere else. Nor do you have a choice, I guess, in the quality. So quality to patient. So USPS is $16 billion in debt. They're ready to cut on Saturdays. The cost of stamps is worse than 150%, right? So you can compare what that government monopoly looks like now and extrapolate. That's how all government monopolies function. That's why taxes continue to go up high to fund these unsustainable liabilities. Social Security, you're forced to pay for that, right? You never gave a contract, never gave a contract. But when it's time for you to retire, there's going to be nothing left for you or I.
The best thing with Social Security is originally, the people who originally got it never put anything in it, so it started off in a negative balance.
Right, well, yeah, that's how politicians sell this stuff. Hey, it's not going to cost so much. It's going to be just this much.
And if it's only supposed to last a year, or the year with the protection,
then it didn't. Right. And it continues. No, of course. They will never want to cut any of those programs. You know, the politician that tries to cut up a program, they won't get elected.
Yeah,
right?
That's what the elderly want
there. Right. So they use you and I as collateral to fund those services. Now, before that, there used to be ways to fund this stuff. Unemployment, insurance used to be provided. They're called mutual aid societies. They're called friendly societies. And people provided unemployment insurance. People provided, in the event like you lost your job, lost your wife, lost your car, you can bounce right back out. They also have healthcare and insurance programs there. So this stuff predated Medicare and Medicaid, and that's how this stuff was given, voluntary, consensually.
What do you think of affordable healthcare act?
I don't know where to start with that. It's funny how you're threatened to sign up for a website that doesn't work, right? And you'll be penalized if you can't figure out yourself in that regard, right? It's not, so when government tries to do their healthcare, the government tries to emulate what a business doesn't threaten you, right? If Wendy's ever threatened you, you never go there, you boycott. Their competitors will point that out and they go out of business, right? You can't do business if you're threatening your customers. So it's kind of funny that sometimes the government likes to pretend they're a business, But behind that, there's a gun pointed at you, right? If you don't comply, right?
And the reason why, like theoretically, the Affordable Health Care Act, Obamacare, or whatever, it would have worked out, but the way it got implemented, and it's kind of like socialism. In theory, it's good. In actuality, it's good.
Yeah, well, yeah. In actuality, it's funded by pointing guns at other people to fund the stuff. It's like Social Security, where we're talking about, right? It's going to become unsustainable, right? In the first few years, yeah, the numbers look legit, but, you know, the politicians who tell you that are not going to be in office the next, you know, 4, 6, 12 years down the road, right? So they'll say what they have to say to appease the people here, to give them what they want, but not telling the true cost of these programs. So they're unsustainable, they're going to collapse, and when that happens, you're going to have a situation like Detroit. So Detroit had a monopoly on a lot of services, but there are unfunded liabilities. Like, it takes over an hour for the police to respond to 911 calls, for example, right? So yeah, I want security, I want all these things. But because government doesn't allow you to have the freedom to cancel and subscribe or to compete, you don't have good sustaining, good quality of these services. You have like the roads here. It's like driving around the moon, potholes and everything, right? Not good quality. You have, again, like USPS, brand new federal status. You have like the incident in Charlottesville with the ABC monopoly, running that young girl coming out of Harry Peters with soda water, right? You have a lot of negative stuff that comes with these monopolies. A business that ever does that goes bankrupt, right? They're not in business. I would say, look, come with me, you know, here's my customer review rating system. Here's my, like, Etsy or eBay. You know, you don't do business if they have a bad reputation, right? When government has a monopoly, they can't go bankrupt.
Right. Well, they can. They just
got your own. Well, yeah, no, that's true. Well, in that sense, yeah, everyone goes bankrupt. But you can't say, like, you can't cancel on subscribe. You can't, like, sue a judge if you make a bad error. You can't sue a state property. You have a unity, right? A lot of politicians have a unity. Police have a lot of unity. But, of course, if the same actions they do, someone else's stuff, if they're not in the government.
Like, it's like cheating. You seem possible.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, so it's wrong if you do it, but it's okay if they do it, right? It's wrong for you to steal, but we're going to call it taxes, right? It's wrong for you to do X, Y, and Z, but the laws only apply to you, not to us, right? Okay, so the whole point of this, I guess, the table and the sign, so the opposite of what government is would be a free society based on consent, right? Because there is no factual evidence you can show me a consensual relationship with government.
How would you design a society where that would work?
Right, that's a good question. Okay, so some of this stuff kind of exists today. Like contracts, you can show me a contract with your mortgage, well, I don't know if you have mortgage, but like AT&T, Netflix, your car payments, right, house payments. Yeah. Real contracts you get signed, like you move to an apartment. Here's the rules, here's the consequences. Okay, I can agree to those rules. Explicit consent, right? You don't have the same relationship with government, right? You don't have a contract with them. So a free society would be based kind of similar to those particular small areas that we have now. So what Virginia is then, they have a monopoly on a community. The majority onto the minority, right? Preference, right? 51% over the 49%, right? Mob rule. So without that monopoly, then you have thousands of competing communities catering to your lifestyle preference, right?
So how would you establish that?
Well, you establish it first, like in our own interpersonal relationships. Our own interpersonal relationships are not the deal, right? You have the freedom to associate or disassociate when you want to, right? If you think someone's abusive, like, I can't be friends with you. Right, or, you know, get a divorce. Or you say the same thing to a friend who's being abused, right? Unfortunately, you don't have that freedom with government to disassociate. It's from the top down. But in a free society, you would have that freedom. You wouldn't have taxes. You wouldn't have these restrictive controls on how best your life would be lived. What you can and cannot do with your own body. That's freedom. That is freedom. And for the most part, most people agree with that definition, right? The freedom, so in a free society, when you have thousands of competing communities, you don't have any more of this, forced preferences. So you can have a cannabis-friendly community right here, one next door that's not, right?
I feel like that, though, you also need it at education.
Well, yeah. Yeah, and education is the name. Education is something that you want to learn, something there's a desire for, right? The government also has one off. in education. That's why tuition cost goes up, right? The quality of education in that regard. So it costs so much to have that information on the computer to get in here, right? But when the government subsidizes everything, yeah, costs will continue to go up in that regard. Inequality will decrease. Like you have high schoolers graduating in New York City who don't know how to read, like over 90% of them. Right? You see, like 100 years ago, the quality of education was great. You know, the reading level for these people were like college level, like 12th grade reading level. Today it's like 5 to 6th grade reading level. You know, over time, when you have a monopoly, it'll go down like your money. And the dollar in your pocket has lost 97% of its value, right? Here's the poor the worst when you have that kind of control, because there's no incentive to save, right? So that's what government is. I want money. I want all this security. I want laws. I want security. But I want to have the freedom to choose, right?
Wait, so how will they enforce, I'm seeing in this society there are new system.
Yeah.
So how would you enforce them?
Right, cool. So it's kind of like you move to an apartment complex that says, cats allowed, no dogs. If you bring a dog in, the penalty on the contract you just signed was like $200, right? So you get real consent to the consequences. It's like, all right, we found it, $200, here you go. I agree to the rules and the consequences. If say, for example, that you don't want to abide by your contract, that's perfectly fine. That information just goes out and says, you're not a person who keeps your contract, keeps your word. Kind of like on Etsy or eBay, your rating system. You know, if you provide a bad product, a bad service, people won't do business with you. You're too much of a risk to associate, right? So the cost benefit of actually keeping your word is a lot more beneficial, more profitable, than it is to kind of break your word contract. But at the same time, since you have thousands of communities to choose from, you know, you wouldn't necessarily want to choose one that starts growing a lot, right? You go to one that is. Like, I like cannabis, I probably move to that community. If I hated it, I'd move to one next door, right? Like the Amish community, right? You have the Amish community, they know that babies can't get consent to the rules, so they wait until the child is of age, like 15 to 18, when they can express real consent to the rules. And the only consequence that they have is social ostracism. And that's what they agree to, so there's no fine or penalty or anything like that. You're just socially ostracized.
What if the penalty is something some people can't, like let's say it's a money penalty, what if they don't have the money?
Alright, I mean, I would assume like in these communities, you'll have friends, you'll have a community, you'll have a non-profit organization, you'll still have people want to help you. There's nothing wrong with passing. I mean, people say, well, what if you're in a dire situation and you have to see, it's like, well, let's back up first. Don't you have friends? You know, I would think so. For me, asking you to be hard might be more than happy, right? You start a Kickstarter campaign, or you do go-go. You know, there's a lot of different ways now to get help from communities all around us, even from people you've never met, to kind of help each other out in that regard, right? But when you don't have nearly half your income stolen from you, taxes, you have a lot more now that you can spend, right? You have a lot more economic freedom to allocate. A lot of the money isn't going to wars you don't want to support, right? Or going to Social Security, which you can't, you know, withdraw when it's time for you to retire.
How will you keep a military
at all? So as we have like thousands of communities, we have thousands of security agents, right? And they all have conflict with one another, and just in case one wants to go initiate force against people, we'll ally with each other in self-defense of that community and other people, right?
So are you thinking more of local government kind of thing? And then, we can band together if we want to, and we can disband if we don't want, instead of, United States?
Right, there wouldn't be United States. It would be a United Free Society. Some of this stuff already exists. Like, have you ever been to a golf course community? Like, they have the security there, the home associations pay for the roads, and pay for that lavish green field. Not my piece of cake, but hey, that's
Florida.
So Florida has a lot of, we'll come a little closer. Florida has a lot of senior communities, right? 55 and older, even preferences. You can't live here if you're 54, you have to be 55 or older, right? So you have a lot of communities based on a lot of interesting preferences, but those communities pay for themselves, the security, the roads. Your shopping mall pays for roads there, right? That road that you walk in, there is a road. The outfield also offer free Wi-Fi, security on Segway, right? And the most aggressive thing you ever come from at a post at a mall would be like, please try this free sample. No, please try this free sample, right? So you have this competitive nature, you know? But at the same time, you have a lot of different people with preferences and backgrounds mixing together in like this economic market. literally don't care where everyone's from. We only care about the new deals or the sales or this movie we're going to watch together here, right? So you can still have a lot of rich, diverse communities who still interact with one another, but at least they have the privacy that they would want, right, in their own community. Whereas here, it's the majority preference onto the minority preference.
I would get UN preference.
I know, right? They probably desperate to want to work with us. So this started here. I guess if you want to change the world, right, we first start with our own community. So we start here in Richmond, right? There's 208,000 people in Richmond. That's a good, small enough number. We can work with that. So like 300 million, and then start worrying about the whole of Europe. And we set the standard and the model here, then the rest will follow. Right? The rest will also want to be just as free as we are as well. Right? So how would the UN handle it? We'd probably create our own version in helping other countries out than what the UN has kind of failed to do in that regard in many of
the
countries.
Most of the UN, like America.
Right? Yeah. We'll still have, again, charities, nonprofit organizations. We'll still get back like that. People ask, like, what about the poor? What about them? Or here or there? It's like, it implies that we care. And primarily, I believe we care about a lot of these things about each other in that regard. And so, there will be an active desire to want to help, but at least we'll have a lot more economic freedom to do it effectively.
How will we handle, companies, like Walmart?
All right, great. That's great. So, without government, corporation ceases to exist. So all a corporation is just a piece of paper that grants CEOs the same immunity that many congressmen have, right? So all escape from their own actions. So they don't get in trouble, they make a lot of mistakes, and they do pollution, that they go rampant, and at the loss of a lot of people's property or their lives, right? So they're able to offset the cost onto employees by lowering their salaries to consumers by raising consumer prices. That same immunity, though, is granted by government, the same that they grant themselves, like from state prosecutors, to them, from judges, to a lot of cops and congressmen. So it's an extension of government. Without government, corporations cease to exist. And goes back to the way it used to be, where individuals are held responsible. We still have businesses, but it won't be the megalithic ones like you have at Walmart or all the Wall Street ones. They get bailed out.
But
the judges, like their immunity, is kind of an important factor. Who's going to
be judged
is
what for every action you've been
holding. Oh, that's a good question. Okay, so what is a judge then? It's just a person who feels, people feel like they have a good, honest, and fair opinion. That's all they're doing. Here's my honest and fair opinion in these matters, right? So in a free society, you get to choose your arbitrator. Like, he has a good 10 years of doing this, you haven't seen any complaints, you look for this person with you, perfect, great stuff, great comments. But this is like a good person to kind of resolve this thing. That's all they do, is resolve this thing, right? But at least it'll be one in which when you enter the courtroom, he stands up for you, right, because you're getting the salary. Not in which you have to be fighting if you don't stand up, if you say the wrong thing, if he holds you in contempt of court. That's unfair if I'm paying the salary, right? It should be the other way around. Well, I'm in charge, otherwise I'm going to someone else who's going to take my throat.
So how does justice get?
Government has a monopoly law. So without that monopoly, you have a competing legal system. You have a polycentric legal system. Kind of like the community in which there's cannabis is not allowed, but you smoke cannabis and you consent that you wouldn't, right? Because this is not a 1420 community, you sort of group you want to go otherwise, but it'll be enforced in which those who love you agree that the county will be $200 fine. Or it could be a telephone. You can have a lot of different interesting ways to experiment with it because you could consent to the consequences, right? So it could be a wrestling match. It could be a fine, it could be a paper review, it could be a victim, it could be victimized, it could be a lot of different ways, but at least the people around you won't be forced to participate.
Yeah, this office would have this so people can, people who are in power, they get
the
same power
you
that
you
said wrong
because they've been there for now here. Okay, that's wrong. Oh, they have like seniority, they have
It's like
10 years,
I guess.
Yeah, 10 years, right. So, yeah, you're not protected by that. You're protected by the merits of your work, right? Your reputation. The goods, the value that you offer, that this is a man for, right? If you do a great job, yeah, there will be a market for the service. Instead of paying people whether or not they're good or they do an efficient job, that's what they do, right? Literally, you would have a lot of incentive then. You open up the free market of a lot of ideas and a lot of people who can compete, providing you a better service, right? So like the ideas that I'm presenting now are not the ideas. You liberate the market, you have millions of awesome ideas that you can use. Okay, well, I have a better way that can solve that problem. You trick me, and this guy will call it out.
How would you combat, like, bias towards a person? Like, let's just say, like, some sort of change, like, gave all back some more specific stuff about a certain person, so they didn't get followers.
That's a good one. Because you don't have really a right to your reputation.
Yeah.
You don't have a right on what people are thinking. So if someone wants to go in like that kind of dishonesty, it's like, well, the same thing can happen in reverse when you found out that they did that's made up, right? Like if Consumer Reports was taken off to get a good review on a product and their competitors find them in third waiting for something like that to happen, so they can say, no, we're the ones that compared to. So I don't know if it would be profitable really to be dishonest in that regard, but if there's factor efforts or otherwise, they're ruling themselves, right? And if in a market where social officers and yourself, the most effective tool, I would say, to prevent would-be aggressor or would-be fraud or would-be thief, like, we're going to go be stood from any member of our society. No one's going to have a key to prove the budget for the time. Stop writing children in that public course, right? With Krillin and Adderall. That'd be the first thing I would stop with that aspect of it. So again, we have a lot of parent interests with one another. In the past, there used to be unemployment insurance, there used to be health insurance for a lot of like ways of immigration in the United States. The government didn't like that. They don't like the last thing they want is people becoming dependent. They need you to become dependent on government, because that's how the problem popped up, right? I would say, how do you help mental health issues? Well, that goes into a tricky, sensitive area, because you can't just be against government violence. You have to universalize it. It's the violence between each other, and especially the violence that's done to others. And a lot of these mental issues arise from, being hurt, as I saw, from their parents or strangers. Spending, for example, the teachers to follow that violence is where they saw problems when they grow up. Aside from the medical and scientific view that says, that's shown a positive relation, and that's traumatic abuse, especially for the child between the age of 4 and the brain is still developing, you can knock off by keeping it, right? The number of different kinds of traumatic events, physical, neglect, verbal, sexual, these kind of things can lead to a positive relation to criminality, to mental health effects, suicide, addiction. So if you want to stem and prevent this sort of stuff, then you kind of have to universalize. Like we were asking the first question, that I don't use violence to solve my problems, that also be accepted. The third communication is this part of the fear of the problem again. And we should try to find ways to negotiate with them, ways to find a plurality of non-violent solutions, right, to interact and to communicate with the child and to defend them. Because then all that child is learning when they grow up is to respect the floor and ask the question, right? Because of titles. And when they grow up, they don't question titles, they don't question authority, they won't question others, right? They won't question their sons, the fear is looked down upon them like they have. So it's all really much very connected, I would say. So we want to go to a better society, to start off with the values we already share. I don't use violence to solve my problems, let's start with that. Right? Let's universalize that principle so you know it doesn't matter who you are, what title you have, what kind of content you are creating, but it's wrong and wrong to initiate that.
How would you even get this started?
We have other chapters, doing this in other city now. It will take a little while, but start first. Case starts here at home. Not overseas, not in White House, D.C. or places that we've been to. But within ourselves, within our own relationship with the world, right? right? So we have like monthly gatherings, we have monthly events, we have monthly parenting events, we have a lot of things going on. Have you heard of Bitcoin?
Yeah.
Yeah, what have you heard about Bitcoin?
The price is going down.
Right. That form of slavery is abolished.
when we all become abolitionists, that word in Hebrew literally goes away, right? And as a society as a whole, our grounds have been fulfilled, right? So when we reach this society in which we're not having children, we're practicing the plurality of our non-violent solutions, I don't believe that these rallies will go backwards. But you have like the KKK, the numbered in the thousands, several decades ago. Today you have just several hundred left, like less than 1,000 left. You know, it's harder to recruit the youth, right? Who wants to be associated with something like that in the values that are pushed forward? The society just simply ostracizes people with this kind of negative and awful value. So I really don't see how someone would want to turn around and be quiet. I mean, they could quiet. Just voluntary consensual.
Right. But let's say like you have a complete job, right? And it's really awesome. Let's say like you're a fan,
Yeah.
So it's pretty good. I think you get a lot of money.
They do what?
They usually like get paid a lot of money.
Yeah.
To keep that up.
Yeah.
Like, technically, since it's no taxes, then they don't have to pay taxes, right?
Right.
So, don't they just do something?
Yeah, and he's one of the ones. He doesn't know what to do with all
that money. Got it. Like, if you were giving him money, you don't have to buy gas or whatever.
Right.
How do you stop that from happening with Bitcoin?
They could buy all the Bitcoin, for example? Even if they buy all the Bitcoin, at some point they're going to have to sell it or trade it if they want to, get a value from it, right? But at the same time, you can only buy Bitcoin for those who are willing to sell it to, right? You can't take it from everyone because they're hidden. They're on their digital wallets. You have a lot of people who have them and who don't want to sell it. You really can't get all the Bitcoin. You can try to go on the market and buy, I think maybe a quarter of the Bitcoins are available to purchase. Corporate credit to buy all that. For a lot of people, that'll be a big rush to kind of move them in that direction. But there's like a mining pool, for example, in which they have 51% of like the hashing rates. They realize that they don't want to have that much control, so voluntarily they split up, right? Because they want Bitcoin to succeed. So you have interesting cases in which people got somewhere close to that situation, but without a government, they still self-regulate. Right? Yeah, it's like, well, this is gonna be bad for everyone, so let's break it up, right? And that's what we did. So if we do that, beautiful. That's awesome. That's a great appreciation for Bitcoin. That's something that you don't see a lot, other areas, of course, the government monopoly, the Federal Reserve. So, I don't know. I really don't see how Bitcoin is going to kill anyone in that regard. For anyone who is part of the Bitcoin investment, it's really difficult to do it. Because it's public, so it's such a legend, so you can kind of see where a lot of the big purchases are coming from. But I don't really see how you can do anything to change it on Steam. Maybe for a few months, someone may try, but inevitably it'll just bounce right back up. Yeah, but it's also, about Bitcoin, that is amazing. That's...
You're a gamer?
You're a gamer? I view that as a future currency, right? When you have that, you have real value in that development, real exchange and portability. And there's 7 billion people in the world, 6 billion that have cell phones. That's really all you need, or an email address, right? So you can do paper wallets, you can do paper trade for Bitcoin. Great thing for the poor. You don't need a bank account, you don't need social security, you don't need all these documents. A wallet with free. Right? There's a guy who did like a $6.3 million transaction on Bitcoin. It cost him only 6 cents. If you did that with PayPal, it would have 3% So there's a lot of interesting ways to pick. You have all the 7-Eleven.
all this in Mexico, and except Bitcoin, you have,
what'd you say you've heard about all of them, Bitcoin.com,
so I think that's beautiful, and at least you have your freedom of privacy, right?
Which you don't have with your bank account, so anything that has government control.
So I would say they'll be very much well prepared for something like that. but if this is a surprise attack, by just saying. All right, well, to say it, you're saying, well, we could get, I don't think it could spread, right. Only for one reason. So if this was a piece of community, because now everything's contractual. Like if my security company wanted to go warlord mode, I'd be like, go to my computer, cancel, unsubscribe, and they go bankrupt the same day, right? Because there's no taxes. Netflix tried to do the same thing, they forgot that people can cancel and subscribe anytime they want, and they cost so much. So at the same time, a business doesn't do just business with consumers, they do a lot of business with other businesses. So like that security company has a lot of contracts with the water companies, utilities, with food services, there's a lot of logistics that goes into play with funding security companies. And so I would imagine that the first moment that they want to go warlord mode, these other businesses like, whoa, we don't want to be known that we're associated with warlords, like we lose our customers. So they'll cut off their services.
What if these cities were going with each other?
With each other?
No, like, centralized government.
What would they go to warlords? What would they want to do?
I don't know.
Land is an easy one. Alright, so the United States government has a monopoly on land, right? They have eminent domain, they can take the land anytime they want. So you already have what they're describing here. You already live in a world war zone. With eminent domain, the government can take your land anytime they feel like it, if it's for the greater good.
If you have a house, and it's in where they want to hide it,
right?
Like, here's the value of your house.
Right. Exactly. No, so there's no respect for private property. So in a free voluntary society, there is respect for private property. There is contract. The judge is security, all respect for private property. So if there's like dispute, they will have a real reason to want to resolve it because violence is a very problem. The only reason you can sustain armies is through tax. The only reason like Hitler wants to take over France through tax, take over the tax. Without tax, you have no sustain army, you can't sustain that. You can't sustain it on a business property or water. It's very complicated for me to ensure all my security agencies in case they get hurt. No agency would want to take the risk of providing me that insurance package, right?
But there's no military.
We still have security that acts like it's protective of something that's associated with the initiative. But at the same time, if you kind of reverse factors for a second, if you practice peace of parenting too, you don't have a lot of children who have who feel violence is an option. You teach them how to negotiate, you have negotiation skills. To know how to, communicate better with one another, right? How to communicate their needs, how to find other ways to have their needs met, right? Instead of but the borders don't have to be as strict, right? Strict borders that are known to crash with one another, and it would be kind of like economic suicide, right? But you'll still have your, economic centers along these communities, like malls and stuff like that. There'll be businesses too that will pay for the roads if they want to help you get people A and B. And right now, businesses are already trickling, right? Government doesn't build it. They outsource it to the politically connected, to their cousin or to their nephew. We don't have the funds to do those things. The topic of one of these communities, I would imagine before these communities set up with one another, they'll have some mutual agreements before they get close to one another. Like, hey, you might have some problems, so let's sort this out before I invite people to move in to these societies. Outsourcing?
Yeah,
that's a great question. I guess you have so much economic freedom. I guess you have a lot of room for
security. There'd be no taxes.
Right? Yeah, there's no taxes. There's no restrictions on what you can or do with your own body, with your own property. You have the freedom of sway without stretching your skin. They're saying, I need a piece of your pocket. They found like the past 60 years, 60 decades, government restrictions on trade has caused people to be around 75% lower. Because increased restriction goes whatever has cost for businesses to kind of sort of like, this is one of the reasons why healthy food costs so much is to have to pay off the overhead costs of government restrictions. Whereas crap food is heavily subsidized by government, which is why they're so cheap in comparison. What the future would look like when you end this system of violence, that's
a little up to the air, but we have some good ideas in the direction we would go. And that's almost like when you end the institution of slavery, you have a lot of different ways to deal with agriculture, right? That doesn't resolve on the slave line. So, yeah, you'll find a lot of awesome breaks in morality of non-violent species that we can't probably even fathom right now. We know that at least in that direction, we'll be founded on these mutual relationships with qualities of non-violence, which are
inherent to negotiations and negotiation.
Yeah, like using a gift.
Right.
That's what I'm saying.
That
actually helps that. Because when people know that you're an officer, they may not want to work, like, you know, go and contact your company. You know, you're not paying government taxes.
Right.
That's very true. A lot of them do get that. A lot of them are very heavily subsidized by government. So, yeah, you'll have a lot of transparency. You have a lot of companies that will say, look, we don't, hire these kinds of people. We don't practice these particular employment traits. Because now there's, so what corporations love about government is that they can lobby government to pass laws to prevent entry competition. So, the amount of business you have today tells you, in comparison, of the government that could be available, you have a lot of options.
Part of our society, but not the initiation of the world.
So I think that's a good question, because once you liberate Richmond and help the little cities around you, we can put together a plan and see what about these other ones, because I haven't thought that far off. But I think that's definitely what I'm saying. I think we can definitely have a lot more momentum, though, a lot more capabilities at that point to figure that part out.
People in those countries,
should they be
the ones thinking about this?
Yeah, and I mean, the internet is a great place for people to find these ideas. You can mail the information to them, you can email them, you can go out there and talk to them as well, right? Like I have a lot of family in Latin America, Bolivia, for example, right? So I'd probably go there after we're done here in Virginia and do the same thing down there. So I think all this kind of interpersonal relationship we have in person also about their and you can only increase exponentially, right? Like once you see the matrix for what it is, you can't plug it back in, right? Forget everything else, right? Forget what is the truth about society around you. And I think that will definitely help in pushing this forward.
It's not like,
once we've all become abolitionists,
you don't really go back very much.
In that regard.
That was a push forward.
So, I mean, that's really our greatest weapon, then, to use our real voice. Not voting, but voting behind your voice, right?
Let's do that. Let's
go up, exactly. The founding fathers, the tyrants thought that you couldn't even decide for yourself. That's got to be insulting, at the very least, to kind of look at that, right?
They didn't want people to vote on the wrong person.
Right. So I think the best thing that we can do right now is use our real voice to just talk to each other. And that's all we're doing. Communicate. That's the only thing the government can't stop us to do, is talk to one another. Right?
And especially,
if you're 150 feet from Obama, they can. In certain situations, they can't. But if the conversations are right here, or at home, or at a cafe, or at a diner, we host a lot of our events actually at a nightclub in Chacabana. The business owners there is really our messages. So I find that as a good message of success, but you can't really stop just people simply talking to one another. I think what we're doing right now. And that's all we have to go to, right? Just an alignment with the values that we have and universalize that and keep moving forward. Yeah, a lot of good questions. Wow, so you can't prepare with that.
No.
What games are you playing online? Civilization?
No.
What are you studying here?
Psychology.
Nice.
I also asked him about mental health, because I know, with the current system, mental health is the first person to get cut.
Right. Well, and a lot of them make up a lot of false diagnoses and things that would be disordered to begin with. Because they also have an alliance with the government, so the government has an incentive to make everyone seem like they're crazy, because now they have an excuse to take you home. There's a guy here in Mexico who said something negative about Obama, for example. Mexico police came in, the Secret Service came in and kidnapped him. They put him in a mental hospital. They have the same thing with people with PTSD from the military. They take away their weapons, disarm them. So it's an interesting connection that they have in association that I find kind of troublesome. Right? Exactly. It is boring. It is. Sorry. It's people are how come you're not paying attention? Well, maybe it's the environment that's not, that's the problem.
It's like you're asking five-year-olds today that for hours on the floor.
Right.
They ain't
got a lot. No. They're moving around like animals. Like you have the prison ball that goes on. You can't stay in a subject that you really like and want to learn and excel in. You have to go around with the
low diversity.
Right.
How did you education do things?
Education would be something totally different than what we have now, absolutely. I mean, everything I learned is pretty much new. A lot of great doctors are out there, a lot of good information is out there. I learned more there than I did going to VCU. So I would say that was very cheap, just being in a service now. But you'll still have, I would say a lot of the higher forms of education would be for really hard subjects, like psychology, engineering. We'll separate the two with liberal arts in a different area. You'll still have crazy
right now I'm taking classes I don't want to be in. I have no interest.
Right.
Yet I still
like my GPA. Right? It's what does this have to do with psychology?
Exactly. I can see some correlation, but it's like not very.
Because
like I'm in biology right now. I'm like the worst at biology, especially cell biology. I'm like, I don't know.
Right. Nothing to do with that. So.
Like
the one-on-one courses, like I just want to do engineering, that's all I want to do, excel at, give me a little math, all the, that's what I want to focus my attention. What do I need to learn for?
Maybe you can pay for it.
Right, yeah.
You have to pay for
$1,500 for
undergrad. I'm out of state, so that's even
more. Oh my god, yeah.
My tuition without any, loans, scholarships.
See, so tuition wouldn't be that high if government didn't subsidize it. Because then government schools like, well, we know government's going to subsidize these loans, so we can keep increasing the loan rates because money's going to automatically come in anyway. So without that monopoly education, or the government subsidy, the cost would go tremendously back then. You still have people who want to...
I guess you do like a Kickstarter kind of thing.
Kickstarter, yeah, philanthropist, write to them. Bill Gates has a great foundation for a lot of international students who want to study. There's a lot of people who do want to help, I guess, in that regard. You have businesses who also have, you know...
And they can be like, hey, you guys can offer this,
and,
you know, we help this.
Right. Even Walmart, I think, gives away like a few $1,000 a year. But that's Walmart. But I'm just saying, we have other avenues, other perks, right? And of course, if your money wasn't still in your account, taxes, you have a lot more income that you can invest in yourself.
Right.
Instead of taking these needless classes, a lot of these schools will be like primarily focused, or even niche schools, to help you become the best of the best in the field that you're interested in. Right. Instead of you having to pay for unnecessary gym equipment, unnecessary expansion, that has nothing to do with that.
Like I'm taking foreign language and it's a lab, so I have to pay for like foreign language labs that I don't ever use.
Right. That's what I mean, yeah. So you won't have any of that stuff. It'll be very low or very affordable, and the quality will... So when you have competition, that's what ends up happening. You have quality goes up and costs go down. Like the plasma screen TVs that came out several years ago cost thousands of dollars. Today you can buy a better version, thinner version for $300, right? I may not afford the next iPhone 8 or 10, but by then I could get an iPhone 5, right? Like right now there's an iPhone 6, I think. I could get an iPhone 3 now, right? Very affordable. They're giving away the best stuff for free. Just for you to sign up for subscription plans. So that's what you have. Things become cheaper and quality improves. But the opposite happens if you have a company come out.
Elementary, middle school, high school, college.
It wouldn't be like that at all. It wouldn't be based on age at all. It wouldn't be based, because that's, when you base it on age, that person just trying to train you. The same thing that the military does, right? Based on ranking system, how long you've been in. It should be based on like your capacity. Project that are out there, they're kind of new, trying to kind of help encourage college, relevant to this area of study very early on, right? Encourage their interest, right? Support what it is that they have an interest in. There's a lot of ways you can do all the different exercises and homework to kind of help them excel. And, like, there's like homeschool students, for example, who are also doing well, learn students out there. Well, for me, when I went to public schools, that was a very much of a Lord of the Flies experience, right? So when people say, what about bullying? It's like, well, I wouldn't put them in a bullying environment, which I don't know the parents there and what if they're abusing their child, but that child then is going to abuse all their children. That itself is a very bullying environment. That doesn't keep on me any sorts of skills, but to keep my guard on for any kid who wants to bully me. At least private schools would not have it, right? They would have like, well, we want to speak to the child, we want to speak to the parent. Like, if we have insurances, again, with the parents, that the child would not be bullied here at all, right? We want this to be a safe educational place to encourage the learning, right?
They're trying now.
In public schools, you can't, right? You're forced to go there. You don't have the freedom. Like, there's a young girl in Texas who was charged with altruism, I believe, altruism.
truancy stuff. That's it. Truancy.
Students show up for school, and so the judge said, well, you have to spend the night. So he didn't go to school because he was doing an extra job, so he had to miss a class to help support a family. But of course, the judge doesn't care.
How would you do that?
Well, school would be voluntary. So it's consensual. You wouldn't be in trouble if you didn't use your internet subscription plan, or if you didn't go to something that you pay for voluntarily, right? But since schools are mandatory, you don't have a free internet. So you don't have the choice. You have to.
So how would you try to get everyone to learn how to read and write and be basic?
Well, you have Carnegie gave out over 1,000 libraries for free. You big philanthropist. And so, yeah, people have an innate desire for spread this education. And when you have a lot of profit, a lot of ability to accumulate their capital, accumulate their wealth, all of them wants to reinvest that back into it. So you have a lot of examples in history of that happening. 1,000 libraries that we gave up for free. Huge, right? Right? Yeah, so you have... I'm not sure. So you can have a lot of opportunities. And I think education is wonderful. And I think that's very cheap and affordable today, right? In regards to the internet. Not this time. And then education is something that's innate to them. The desire to understand. It's not something that you give to someone, right? What you give is the space and capacity and encouragement. A teacher is supposed to be like a coach, right?
You don't understand, you guys.
Right, yeah. It's on you. It's like, well, hey, I'm hiring you to help me learn, right? Like private tutors don't do that, right? But private tutor wasn't doing a good job in helping you, you know.
They just get hired.
Right, yeah. You get someone. Right.
And it's all about teaching style, too. Because, kids can't do turned into different classes that they, go.
Right.
And the teacher doesn't need their learning style, so then it's just time.
Right. So at least it'll be a lot affordable. You're not paying for an entire school system, even if you have children or not. You can credit direct that money then to maybe your nephews, right? Or even if you are a parent, you can credit direct that money since you don't have your income's not being stolen. Maybe $100, $200 a month for great teachers in the physical area for your child. Maybe $10 a month for security, right? You have a lot more room for investment for different ways to kind of get investment for these, I think would be awesome. It would be a lot better experience than I had than public schools. We're not a lot of fun to do at all. I would imagine maybe for a lot of people as well. It's for me it was very boring. For me it was very, have to ask permission to use the bathroom. Maybe have to be passes to leave. Sometimes over the schools you can only go 3 times a year. There's 14 states that allow teachers to teach children. Corporal punishment. 2 years ago, the number of children that were beaten by public school officials were over 200,000. Right? So, yeah, very much similar comparison to prisons themselves in regards to the school system we have today. Maybe we'll come across some great educators as well. We have some today. I have a friend who teaches a lot of computers, math. He knows a lot of the teachers that are coming to help children clean lips if they don't pay attention, right? You don't want to have that kind of style of, teaching, prepare your child and scare them. But he does a great job of helping them learn to communicate and use their needs to try to understand where they're coming from. And that'll take a lot of teaching. A lot of
that.
Especially if you're in public schools, you're I'm covered. I'm getting paid whether or not I keep good quality of material.
Isn't that the thing that you're like, without the customization of super talent, you know? Which I think is also kind of bad because, there are some people that they don't like to do bad, so.
Yeah. And a lot of teachers now, so many scandals have come out of teachers that cheated. Students, a lot of schools doing this. This way they can get federal government money, federal grants. So lots of students going all over the country on those tests. So that's not something that you see as a measure of success then of monopolized school systems.
I had to look at it now, my district, don't use their testing. I'm
at your expense.
And now the SAT is now easier apparently.
Right.
And I'm just like...
See? Quality goes down. Quality goes down. Not necessarily I think testings are good because at least a measure of success, but not in the area in which the teachers going to do a good job in coaching you and helping you learn how to trade.
I think it's like, I'm pretty smart, but when it comes to Sarah's thing, I'm like,
Right, yeah, and there'll be different ways to kind of, I guess, to match or see your growth of this education, right, of your underlying stuff. So I imagine there'll be a lot of ways to kind of have different varieties of teaching styles. This is the going to a classroom, which is an outdated model to begin with, right? That used to be the model when there weren't a lot of copies of books. But now everyone has a copy of the book. You really don't need a teacher to read you that book anymore. He's not the only one with a copy. So I would say many of the teaching models today are outdated. But of course, government is very sentimental, and that's something they would want to.
Yes, but they have like these huge lecture classes that are like 200, 300 people. It's like, how am I supposed to learn in this kind of environment?
Right.
So they offer to ask questions when there's like 200 other people.
Right. There's no connection. Yeah. The quality of the few shapes are going along. So at least if we can examine that now, you can also look like how education was provided in the past. Just like any service the government provides now, at one point in the past, it was provided in the market, voluntary, essential, before government monopolized it and outlawed competition. Like the post office is a great example. So 100 years ago, there was a guy named Alexander Spooner who saw in the Constitution, is not a real compliment. But anyways, he saw it in there, he saw that the post office thinks that they can get a post office. It doesn't say that the exclusive right. You deliver a piece of mail back in, it's like $3.50, really high.
Right now, kids want to make a new post office and make new stamps?
You could, well, it's illegal and fair because it's illegal and criminal for FedEx, UPS, and DHL to deliver pieces of paper. They could only deliver back to the government outlawed competition.
How can you do that?
Exactly. This one guy, Alexander Spooner, challenged the USPS back then. He called his business the American Little Mail Company. He needed it faster, cheaper, efficiently. He's a real business, so he dropped his prices down. Government tried to compete. He dropped even lower because he could do it efficient faster. He dropped it all the way down to 3 cents. And then government like kept suing him until he didn't have anything left. And then the next year, Congress just passed a law and says, all right, you're not going to deal with that again. Because no one is allowed to compete with USPS. And that's why so people say, well, costs are cheap. Well, it used to be 3 cents, right? The products are on a high price, they continue to go lower.
You try to send them into like Europe, it's like, I know if you try to send them to Germany, and it's like just like a sticker, it's only like $50.
Right. Right. And they're still subsidized. Sometimes the post office will say, well, you're a private organization. You don't accept any tax money. They do. They accept, they get government loans with 0% interest rate, very low ones. And of course, other businesses, your business, have no access to. These are funded, of course, back by tax payers.
I'm trying to think how they could do that now. I was like, oh yeah, there's rules in the Constitution that allow that.
Right. So very sneaky stuff.
Because there's one where it gives, like, Supreme Court or whatever, or some sort of, or legislation will have the power to do anything they
want. Right. Something like that. Or like, if you look at, like we were talking about security earlier, the Supreme Court judges have ruled that the police have no constitutional duty or obligation to protect their life, liberty, or property. None. They have no duty. So imagine that now. They're being forced to pay for a service because they don't have to provide. The only time they have to provide is when they're detained, like a victim's crime. But other than that, they have no obligation. They can turn the other way. And that's what brought them down these places. They have no incentive. They all lost competition. They have no need to keep the quality. They're still going to get paid anyway, right? So they have no need to really do any work because they're still going to get paid, right, at your expense. So that's usually the problems with these monopolies, you know, the stagnation. I have a lot of friends who work in the government who's now trying to get out of it, but that agree with the inefficiency that, like they probably do 1 hour's worth of work and spend the rest of the time on the internet and Facebook. but that's at your expense. You're forced to pay for that.
I'm trying to get a government job. Because I want that expense.
Right,
but I work for the VA.
For the VA, right. Yeah, the VA is a great example of the poor quality of care for veterans, right? That kind of monopoly of the whole situation. So over time, the whole thing will collapse. Over time, it's inevitable. You know, so I would like, given the experience that you have now,
sir,
use it as a jumping board to eventually go into the private sector, because that's eventually where you want to go. When things deteriorate even further, you're going to have more, I guess, private background resumes and skills that are even more going to look at.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? Great efficiency. Like, you look at in, what happened in Detroit, the place that's collapsed. So like the mass transit there shut down too.
Hold on.
There's this guy who bought, you have to go? Okay, great. It's a pleasure meeting him.
I'm Sarah Fina.
Well, let me get your email address. I'm going to send you some more stuff.